It's a very detailed work. Leonardo da Vinci was one, Van Rijn, Rembrandt was another one, who did this kind of work to know, to understand what is actually happening behind things. Now, I would say this is a kind of analytical perspective. You analyze the detail, you analyze in detail what is going on there. The other perspective is you just look at things. I don't know if you saw ever the Mona Lisa. I never met her in person, she was so busy, so I skipped that part. But you just look at somebody and see the smile, and you are able to paint it. Now, you have to be Leonardo da Vinci to be able to paint it, but it is not an analytical perspective, it is just looking at something and getting something out of it, being able to see what is actually happening. Now, coming back to the toolbox and the tools, of course, what you see is a different thing. What you just see, if you take a visual perspective, is something different than what you see, what you understand, if you take such an analytical perspective. There is another dimension to it, and we are always dealing with it, directly or indirectly. That is the perspective on ideas, ideals, or the material world. We talked in economics about it, that sometimes we can determine objectively this is the value of something. And if you look at the term, the word value, it has these two meanings. The value is basically what you pay in the shop. That's what we usually say, this is the value of something. At the same time, the value is about the valuation. We appreciate something. It can be meaningless in terms of the material value, but it has for us some value for whatever reason, sentimental value. So these are different ways, and these are important basically to understand the complexity in which we are thinking. It's another Leonardo da Vinci, the dimension is not completely correct. But what he did is he looked at the beauty of this person and at the same time at the beauty of the person in his environment. How does this person fit into this environment and how does he act within this? As I said, I take very much a Western perspective, simply because I have been growing up there most of the time. But you find the same thing actually in what is usually called the Asian perspective, the yin-yang, that is the concept of harmony, of things fitting together, if you want. And it is not, that's the analytical perspective, too white and too black areas. But they are related to each other, and you cannot have the one without the other. And you cannot have them in this form with the same or with a different meaning. There is a connotation, and this is what I said in the beginning, there is this connotation, we kind of immediately know what it is about. It's this general understanding. Now you can say this is all very complicated and very abstract. the same time, we can say this is actually very concrete, because there we have clear-cut dimensions, we know what it is about. And this is actually very difficult. Do you have an idea what it is? In a way, you can say it's again black and white. Spots, areas, black, white. What this is, we are, if you want, academic work where research comes into play and where we are learning to use different ways of assessing reality. Because everybody will say, in a second or two, of course this is a job. You just cut it out, you get the forms, and you see what you could not see before. And what now, of course, is very obvious for you. Everybody will say, of course this is done. I knew it. I see it. It's very obvious. But we needed kind of this tool, an analytical tool and a visual tool to allow us to understand what it actually is about. Again, we end up with the toolbox and the tools. We use them in a way you can say to structure the world, to get something out of the world, out of this complexity of black, white dots and areas. We try to use something to structure what we see. Now what we see has at least four dimensions, and I pointed it out during economics when we have been talking about it on different occasions. We are always, if you remember, I talked about Bologna. We are always talking about historical developments. We are talking about an economy, an economic system, a market system today in China, today in Europe, 140 years ago in the United States of America. These are differences. And say we talk about a market society, we are talking about structures. Property, freedom, individuals. These are structures, elements that are joined together in a very specific way. And whenever we do economics, whenever you do your accounting or finances, you are dealing with a very specific pattern of reality. This is the broad picture. If you want the smaller picture, the detailed picture, the everyday life picture, we are talking about processes and materiality. And this means Peter goes to the shop and buys a bottle of water. It's happening in both dimensions. It's part of history. It's part of the structure of a market society today. And it is a part of my concrete action. My process, how I act in daily life. You take the taxi, you take the minibus, you walk. These are things of the market society, and at the same time, it is something very concrete in terms of day-to-day behavior. Talking about economics, talking about understanding economics and learning about economics, you have to understand that we are doing both. Now, I don't tell you a secret, at least it is said by many economists. Usually, we are not looking at this part. We are only looking at the general models, abstract models. As I said in class frequently, we are talking about rational beings, rational decisions, knowing that it is wrong. But at the same time, kind of failing it out. It is always difficult, and this is why you are here in the laboratory, to figure out an understanding what is behind all these processes. You know this quote from the economics? 19th century civilization alone was economic in a different and distinctive sense. For it chose to base itself on a motive only rarely acknowledged as valid in the history of human societies, and certainly never before raised to the level of justification of action and behavior in everyday life, namely gain. The self-regulating market system was uniquely derived from this principle: gain, profit, individual gain, it's not about society. This is history. And this is at the same time what guides our personal behavior. And of course it matters then, it matters very much at a later stage, but you have to be prepared for it. If we use a term like gain or profit, expenses, cost, coming back to the tools, you know, we have to be aware of a very specific understanding of the different terms. And it means at the same time that we are talking and thinking about something. You learned English, and there is a nice English term, it's called Zeitgeist, the spirit of the time. And this is exactly the spirit of the time. We are thinking now about markets in this way of individual gain. There have been always markets in terms of people exchanging things, we talked about it. But now we arrive at a completely new setting. The Zeitgeist, the spirit of the time, the understanding of things changed completely. For me it is actually very interesting to see. I'm a little bit older, but to see the differences over time. When we talk today about market, and when we talked about market 50 years ago. I was some time ago walking with somebody through Moscow, and he said, 40 years ago, walking through Moscow, you could see where you are because there had been certain monuments, meaning enterprises, They had been producing cars, they had been producing tires. You don't see it anymore. Today you see buildings of administration. So in a short period of time you have a huge change. Although we say it's kind of a similar system. We are producing, there is a market. But at the same time, there is this change in terms of how we are working. If you bring your car today to the garage, it will be connected to the computer. There is no dirt. It's a very clean place. If you did the same thing 30 years ago or 20 years ago, it was a dirty place. They hardly knew what a computer is, and they had to listen to the engine to find out what the problem is. So we have the different dimensions of, on the one hand, long historical periods, changes over long periods in time, but at the same time, within these frameworks, we have something more to understand. We can say 1500 and 2000. These are completely different times. We can say in Changsha, living 10 years back or 20 years back was a completely different life. Some areas which are now part of Changsha, built up areas, did exist as part of the city. So it is important, and this is what I want to do for the rest of today, to try to think in two ways. The one is trying to think in a historical long-term perspective. And the other is try to look at details that give you hints, that give you clues to understand things. The really difficult thing is that we have to do it simultaneously. We have to do it at the same time. Because whenever we are doing something, we're creating in a way, not a new world, but a new understanding. We know about the details, and with putting all the details together, we can understand the entirety, we can understand the whole picture. But understanding this whole picture gives us again new ideas about the details. It's about 500 years back. Just want to take him there. Now I warned him that he has to stop me when I'm carried away. Renaissance, the time of rebirth. The time when we actually changed from, and this was a major shift from medieval times to the beginning of modernity. I mentioned already Leonardo da Vinci. If we think about it today, with a real understanding, it was such an amazing step. Leonardo da Vinci knew about blood circulation. He didn't know details, but it was something nobody before knew about it in analytical terms. This is why they tried to change blood and to do blood transfusions in very weird ways. He was building flying machines, meaning trying to basically get off the ground, to work against the, what we would say, it's laws of nature. meaning not simply accepting something, but thinking about things. Then there was, of course, Copernicus, Galileo Galilei, 1564. This was a new, completely new concept of where are we as human beings. We are not the center of the world. And we are not defined necessarily by a god. Now this is a very complicated discussion at the time, but only one thing is important. People thought about themselves trying to find a place in society and being responsible for what they did. This was the beginning, basically, of this rational individual. And there is one room in the Vaticano, in the Vatican Museum, that is actually capturing this new idea of humankind, if you want, the idea of where are we actually standing. It's called the room of the signature. It's a very nice room. It has one problem that you are there with 100 other people that you cannot really enjoy what you agree. But now I come back to what I said before. You have to look at the details and you have to look at the context, at the entirety. The room consists of three frescoes, three paintings. This is the probably most known one, the School of Athens. It's basically presenting ancient philosophy. I'll come back to them later. But this is how thinking developed. People said at that time, we have the philosophy, we have people thinking of the world, but still we don't know what to do with it. So Raffaello was painting something else into this room. That's Parnassus. It's linked to arts and to writing, poetical writing. You don't have to remember the details here, Parnassus or something like this, but it is bringing things, and this is what you do when you do research and you're learning. You bring different perspectives together. Maybe you think about the world, and you feel the world, you think in a very open-minded world, and you just look at the world. It's what I said before, it's a, in a way an analytical approach, and it's a visual approach. Now how do we do this? And there is always and everywhere something that guides this thinking, and that is here, and these are certain values, certain understanding. We'll come back to it later, but a certain understanding of values that guides our learning, our research. This is as well for plagiarism, by the way. It's unethical. You don't do this. You are just honest. This is one of the elements. And then, I would not buy into this, But this was Raphael's solution, meaning basically Christianity. It's not, as I said, it's not really about the details. But it is about trying to get aware of with what we are dealing. Yin Yang. These are principles where we have an understanding that guides our research and that guides our learning. The values, especially at the time, by and large, they are still kind of valid and widely accepted, are fortitude, prudence, and temperance, and justice. As I said, you can see literally the meaning of this. I could go into details and say why this is fortitude with a mirror, why this is temperance, looking, taking care. No, the mirror is in the middle of the tree, and fortitude with fighting the lion. Details, not so interesting. What is interesting is that justice is actually not part of the core painting, but it is, in a way, you can say, standing over all the values. It's not easy to define what justice is, but I guess it is very difficult, even more difficult than to define what justice is, to find somebody who openly, frankly says, I am not just and I do not want to be just. Everybody will say, whatever he or she does, well, yes, it is just. If I earn more, 20 times more than you, it's just, because I'm better, because I'm not honorable. So justice is this kind of, in this understanding, the overall, overarching value. And as I said, the other dimension is just this feeling of harmony. Yin Yang, if you want, to feel one with the environment, to be part of it. You can say, to each of them, it's just a nice painting. It's just a nice fresco. It looks nice. But as I said, the idea is to capture really an entirety of the understanding of the world at that time. There was no market in our sense. There was simply people engaging with each other on the basis of these values. And this is something I want to draw your attention to. That there had been, on the one hand, this understanding of, for instance, and especially justice, but at the same time, these societies have been extremely unjust. They have been extremely hierarchical. They have been controlled by a small minority of people in political terms, in economic terms, and the rest didn't have anything to say. Try to understand this as a serious issue of, we are talking about a wide field of general values, of general harmony, but at the same time, we have a very specific understanding of it. And this is something where you have to go and exercises are. If you go here through the city, you can see just built-up arrows. If you go the back entrance or whatever the name is, there are high-rises, there are buildings, doesn't really look nice. If you go a little bit further and go into this estate, you see actually pretty nice areas with park inside and many greenhouses. Observe it. Don't take any picture first glance, but try to analyze it with different means. And then I come to this main painting, really. In this way, that it is the most traditional painting. Everything that is included here is basically a little bit of a reflection of what I said in the beginning. We are standing on the shoulders of giants, and we are not doing much more than adding footnotes to Plato. It's not about Plato, but very much of the knowledge we have today is based in the ancient societies. If you go back to Confucius, if you go back to Mencius, if you go back to Aristotle and Plato, basically you have four people, and with this you have the fundamentals of our world understanding today. There are different ways of understanding, and they mark one crucially important point with which we are struggling permanently today in economics, not least in economics. If you look at the right, the guy in red in the middle, that's Plato. Now there is one interesting thing, and this is what we always do in academic work. He points upwards. Which means there is an idea, and this idea is guiding us. We don't have to bother about the reality. The ideas are there. If you read Plato, I said once in a lecture, it's better to read, and some people say, well, forget it. And next time somebody came back and said, it's actually literature, that's a dream, I really enjoy it. It is about having ideas, and living means basically activating these ideas. The ideas are there. Whereas Aristotle, if you look at the hand of Aristotle, had a different approach, showing at the world and saying basically, and this is what we have to do, look at the world, analyze the world, and only then you will be able to understand what is going on. It is not by just thinking, by having some ideas. It is by analyzing the reality. If we go back to the toolbox, criticism with Plato. Ideas are guiding the world, ideas are structuring the world. Versus materialism, we have to look at the material conditions, at the reality. And only then we will understand what we are talking about. Now we can do, we have the water there, we can do some tricky things and put a stick into the water, into glass. Stick, straight stick, do it. You will be amazed what is happening. And now I give it up to you for the evening to think about it. What is happening? Is the change of the stick happening in my head? Is it really changing? Because it changes, I tell you so often. It won't be a straight line. What is happening? How can we understand it? And this is what we are doing in academic work, in science, and in learning. And learning is very much about looking at the truths. What can we do? Can we count things? Can we see things? Can we touch things? Can we really touch things? Or do we need other instruments? I could go on for another 2 hours, I won't. This was just a kind of illustration, but you see some nice paintings. We will come back to nice paintings as well, some paintings from Asia, Chinese artists. The bottom line of today, if you want, look at complexity, look at the entire world, and never forget this. Whatever you are doing when you look at details. When you calculate your formula, look at the formula and say, there may be different options, there may be different answers. The second, there are certain tools, you have to use them appropriately. You have to, you can only use the tools for a certain purpose. You cannot count everything. You cannot calculate everything. And some things you will only understand if you calculate them, if you count them. You need different ways. And you have to be always, and this is technicality then, you have to be always precise. Plagiarism, words, think about it, and say, why do I come to this result? I can conclude with something terrible. I did not mention any reference, I just provided these pictures and information. You can contest this and say, I should show all the references. It is always a little bit as well a matter of where and what are you doing. At the end of the day, at least I will be able to show you exactly from where I have it. This is the most important thing. If you take something from the internet, if you take something from the search engine, look at it and understand it. Don't just cut and paste it for your own benefit. It may be wrong, and you may be in a situation where you do not know what you are doing with this information. Information, bottom line, information and knowledge are different things. In academia, in learning, we are looking at knowledge. And we are looking at how we can obtain knowledge. So I'll leave it here. If you have immediate questions, you can ask them now. We can get to it on Thursday. And Jenny will be your assistant to explore this model. Thank you.